Hi, and welcome to G7CR Spotlight, Season 1, Episode 13. Today we have with us on Spotlight a very, very interesting lady, someone from Bhojpuri. Radhika Kumari, welcome to G7CR Spotlight. So what is the worst thing ever you ever eaten to date?
Boiled vegetables.
Boiled vegetables?
There's one incident where I was being kidnapped.
Seriously?
Now I will really not care what people say and I'll do what I like. My dad is a motivator for me because he has struggled a lot. He will never do anything for himself, never shop for himself. But for us, he's always. If anyone questions on my dad or raise a finger on him, I won't leave them. First job, so it's my first experience I can count in my life for bringing me a change from normal girl to a corporate girl.
Today we have with us on Spotlight a very, very interesting lady. Okay. Someone from Bhojpuri. And I just realized today on the way, if she speaks to us in Bhojpuri on the show, we won't be able to translate it with Google Translate. Because it's one of the few languages which Google also does not translate. So welcoming the woman who basically ensures our salaries comes on time, by basically ensuring our customers pay us on time. Radhika Kumari, welcome to G7CR Spotlight.
Sir.
How are you feeling on the show today?
A bit nervous?
Okay. Now, I remember when you were selected, your reaction was, I was praying that I should not be selected. So why you didn't want to be selected for the spotlight?
Camera shy, so and I'm nervous of being on stage, so that's the reason.
But you're feeling better now, right? No cameras now in this room. You're just talking to me. That's it.
That's right? Why I can imagine and feel better.
Excellent. So Radhika, a lot of people want to get to know you in G7. I mean, the whole idea of the spotlight show is to get to know the individual, understand who you are. So we know what you do for G7. Okay, I don't know if everybody knows that, but. You've been very responsible for ensuring our payments come on time, talking to our customers, following up with them, getting them, reminding them that you know the bills have to be paid, ensuring the money comes in so that we can pay people on time too. So thank you so much for that, and that's what you do for G7. I'm hoping everybody knows, they'll come to know at least after this. So let's talk about you as an individual. I would like to start with how was Radhika as a kid?
I'm attached to my mom.
Okay.
So if at all I get to know my mom is going out, I won't allow her to go. So I was always stick to her.
Okay.
When my mom says the stories when I was kid, okay. I never used to leave her to eat or freshen up or anything. I always used to be stick to her 24/7. So okay. Very shy and calm.
Okay.
That way.
Do you remember you not letting your mom go out anywhere? Till what age were you attached to
her? I remember when I was at age of 8, when my mom was going to village, leaving me and my with my dad. But me being me, I would not leave her. So she went. She didn't let me know that she's going. And after she boarded the train, I called her and I was crying. Please come back. I don't want you to go. Please come back. And I didn't eat food and nothing. And then they took me to her.
Wow.
From here to Uttar Pradesh, they took me in car. And when I saw her, when I reached at my place, there were more people and it's wedding time. So I didn't know my village. I was not aware of my village, which it is, because I've never visited there. So I saw and I ran back thinking that my mom is not here. I have bought to some wrong place and I ran back. My uncle came holding me. Come, I'll take to your mom. And then they brought me to my mom and I just hugged her and I cried like, why did you leave me and come? Then after that, that's the one moment which I remember. So.
No, it looks like a very emotional moment for you, although you were
I remember that the way I used to call her and cry, please come back. And she'll be like, I'm coming, just wait there. I'm coming back. Okay. But she ended up in village and then they took me there.
So, is the attachment still the same?
Or yeah.
Still the same. Cannot live without mom, not for a minute.
I can think of my dad going out and I can be with that, but not my mom. Even from office if we go or from school anytime, where's mom?
Okay.
The one thing comes opening the door, mom, where are you? So
now I can imagine Radhika when you were going to first time to school, 3 years, I could imagine you kind of shouting and crying that you will not go. Were you that kid who cried every day to go to school?
That my mom didn't say anything
about. Didn't say anything.
No, she never said. There's one incident where I was being kidnapped.
Seriously?
Yeah, I was just 2 years.
Uh-huh.
And the tenant of my home, I mean owner of my home, he kidnapped me. Son, he was a kid, 14-year boy.
Uh-huh.
And
you were 2 years old?
Yeah, I was just 2 years old. My mom told me this. He just kidnapped me and he threw me in the roadside and he ran away. Then my mom...
This is in Bangalore?
Yeah, Bangalore.
Oh man, seriously, wow.
So then after that, they were finding me everywhere, but they couldn't find. So somehow, by God's grace, the person who used to come in that area to Dhobi person,
right.
He saw me and the news was spread all over. And that's when he kept me. He took me from that place and he took me to doctor, everything. And then my mom got to know I'm here. Then they came and they took me back.
Oh, this is frightening, man. Oh, okay.
I've never said about this to anyone. I'm just saying here because if it comes to child, all things come out just like that.
No, we are really happy that you're safe actually speaking after that, because that's almost like anything could have happened, right?
Anything could have happened. Wow. I was just 2 years and nobody knew. My mom, like I said, I was not leaving my mom. She left it to my dad. You keep here, I'll just go and come. And my dad, he gave me a pen, play with it and he go. Okay. And this, I went out of the door and the person took me from there.
And that guy who did it also was a young guy.
14 years old.
But for him also, it was like a game. It was more like...
it was like a game. Maybe he didn't like us being there.
There, achcha.
And they had a little problem.
Some
with
problems,
their
family, Wow. Okay. Man, that was a experience. I'm happy
and
you don't
know that
it.
That person is still there. Once we were visiting from that place, so my dad said, this is the home where we used to stay. And my mom said, this is the man who used to took you. And I saw and okay. Wow. I can't do anything.
But how was it growing up in Bangalore? Because you've been born, brought up, everything in Bangalore,
everything,
right? So school, everything.
Everything. School, college, degree, job. Marriage, everything will be here.
Everything is going to be here. Okay, marriage, we're going to come to that soon. We will ask you about that. Let's talk about school now. I mean, in school, do you remember how was school like in Bangalore? I mean,
for me, school was an interesting part of my life, I can say, because most of the things which you do is in school, whether it is studies or friends or cultural activities, anything. So I enjoyed my school a lot.
Enjoyed the school. Were you into drama or dancing or singing or anything?
Cultural and sports, always yes.
Sports. Which game you used to play?
Almost every, except for throwball and volleyball. Okay. Rest every sports I've played and always on top.
Wow, excellent. Okay.
But when I moved to PUC, that's when everything stopped, even cultural and sports.
Were you good at studies in school? Were you teacher-specced? Teachers liked you?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was, in fact, a head girl of the school.
Oh, you were head girl of the school. Wow, interesting.
So we have like elections and based on that, they'll choose the head girl and the head boy of the school and then followed by captains and everything. Okay. So I was the head girl for that. And it was not a vote. There was no competitions for me. Wow. I was the single lead and everyone just selected me.
Wow, man. Okay. You're planning to enter politics soon. You won elections.
I don't like politics.
Punishment in school. We all have punishments at some time or the other. Anytime you did something.
I remember I've never got punishment, but mathematics is something which I don't like. And my professor called me for solving a problem and I was not aware of that. So that's one place where I have got beatings. And after that, I never went to solve any mathematics. And from then till now, I still don't like mathematics. And I remember that person for that one formula, he had just hit me.
What was it like in terms of, the memories that you have of school? What was Radhika like in school? I mean, what were you dreaming of? What were you thinking you'll become? Because as kids, we all have these thoughts, right? See, I remember when I was a kid, I used to think I'll become a pilot. Okay, so what was Radhika thinking? I mean, what was the experiences you had in school?
That time, we definitely were not aware of corporate lives or anything. So if anyone used to ask, what is your aim? We used to say doctor.
Doctor.
Even if I was good in science or something, I would prefer doctor, not engineering or anything, because some sort of thing which I like in biology is about knowing human body, which I like to know new things.
Right.
And in every single thing, I want to know why it is that way.
Right.
So I would prefer biology and doctoring.
Man, this is very strange, Radhika. You believe me? Every girl who's come here to date on Spotlight, everybody have said I wanted to be a doctor. Okay, for some reason, actually, I don't know. Okay, this is coincidental, maybe. I'm hoping the next Spotlight, let me see. I'm going to ask the person the question and see. But everybody have told me we want to become a
doctor.
A doctor, and some reason or the other, why you didn't pursue? Maybe you could have pursued.
When we are kids, we see our parents like they are not well or something, so they go to doctor or anything.
Right.
We'll be like, even I'll do doctor, right. And I will treat my parents or right. others also. So I will take care of them. So that way.
Right.
So that gave me a motivation of.
But why you didn't pursue? I mean, you.
When we grow, we get a little sense. When we are kids, we prefer like, yeah, I'll become doctor or
that's
a pilot
dream,
or
yeah.
anything. But then when we grow, we see different circumstances in life. Sometimes financial crisis, sometimes you'll have to go according to the family and all that things. So I just, when I joined my PUC, I remember I was not even in Bangalore. I had been to my village because my grandma had expired. So when I came, there were no seats available. So I thought, okay, let me go with BCom then. So I joined in BCom Streamline, and then after that, I dropped all the plans what I had.
Sad. But I think you can still try now. Maybe
now,
you never know.
I'm little very. I don't like studying and
studying
exams.
Now?
I don't like. So
oh,
what
thank
I've
you for telling me.
Completed. That's more than enough for me now.
How was in school? Usually, everybody in school has a crush or something like that way. So, which was your first
crush? I remember
crush?
This thing. Oh. I was a very shy kind of person in school, and I used to not talk much. We were just 9 girls in our class, and these 9 girls was from LKG to 10th standard. Not even one decreased or increased. So we were only in that much gap. But then in 7th standard, I remember where my teacher's son was having a crush on me, and I was not knowing this because the children who were in the tuition, in that teacher's tuition, they knew about this. And one fine day, I got to know and they gave me a letter. Now, I know my dad. He'll kill me if
what was written in the letter?
I mean, it was just a normal random thing, so I did not react to that. I just threw it away.
The letter. Okay.
I threw it in the balcony side of my school, where anyone can go and take that letter.
Yeah, you got caught.
So there were a few students, few friends of mine, they took that, and I don't know what was their intention. They did a copies of that letters, and they spread it all over the class, and then they were all like blackmailing. Mm. If I will tell to the teacher that this is what is happening, I said you can go and say it's her son's fault, not my fault. You can go and say. And then few girls, we spoke to them, and they said no, we won't do that. Mm. But this guy showed up, and he gave the letter, and teacher's son, obviously teacher will be feeling humiliated.
Okay.
So she just slapped him, and then after that everything went normal. After that was the incident where they also did that girls shouldn't talk to boys now, and they segregated girls and boys in the same classroom.
Achha.
And that continued till 4 years, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 4 years.
4 years they segregated boys and girls, oh my god. But anyway, I'm so happy schools today are a little more open-minded to this concept.
Because it was a teacher's son who did that, so she didn't want it any bad impression to happen. So they did all this.
And did this reach home? Did it reach your mom, dad? No, never.
My brother was aware. We all have studied in same school from childhood. So my brother was aware of this.
Okay. You have an elder brother, right?
Yeah.
Elder brother and one
younger sister?
Younger sister. One younger sister. So you're in between.
Mm-hmm.
You're not the first, you're not the last. Okay. So are you the most loved one or?
Yes, we can say I'm the
most loved one at home. Yeah.
Because if we compare to childhood and even now, they listen to what I say. Like what I want, they will get it for me. Compared and I will dominate my younger sister.
Okay.
Elder brother, not that. I am not in that thing with him.
So, when you were in small, growing up, who was the person you looked up to in family? I mean, it was dad, mom, my elder brother. Who was the person who you would go to when you have a problem?
My mom.
Mom. Okay. Okay. So mom has always been the strong support.
Always.
Always. Excellent.
Because I am scared of my dad. So.
Dad is strict.
He's very strict. Okay. Mom is also strict, but she knows in some situations where to be supportive.
Right. So how many times you got beating while you were in school?
Beatings, one with the maths professor.
No, at home.
At home? No, at home I've never got beatings. But
you never
yeah,
got beating at home? No. Man, modern parents, my parents used to beat me up that.
No, because we they were strict and we used to follow what they
say. So you were scared by default, so you never did anything
never
to get beating.
Okay. But I remember when my brother used to teach mathematics, I used to cry because I couldn't understand that. So my dad always supported there. If you don't understand, relax and take some time and understand. No need to cry. He always say that. Always be strong, don't...
Amazing.
Never let yourself down because of some other things.
You're not following that advice, but
yeah.
I've seen you cry more than once.
More than once. So he'll say always that. Uh-huh. He also see me at home when now since work from home is going on, sometimes things go high and everything. Right. So he'll be like, relax, and if there's any problem, let us know. But don't get overstressed because of the work or anything. Right. So keep yourself calm.
I mean, good man. Very, very nice parents. You got a good support system at least at home. You got dad, mom was there to basically support you, listen to you.
My dad is a motivator for me because he was 14 years when he came to Bangalore.
Oh, wow.
After my grandfather expired and he started his work here as a painter. He is now interior designer. So he have struggled a lot. He bought that. They tell us the stories of how they used to grow up and everything. Right. So he's a motivator for us. If anyone questions and my dad or raise a finger on him, I won't leave them.
Amazing.
It's because sometimes what happen, they'll be like, if even you are a owner of the company, you know the struggle what you have gone through, and you know the struggle how you have bought to bring your family up. And at that point, if children don't respect or some outsiders question you, that is not acceptable. So he's a motivator for me.
Excellent. And I think it's inspiring when somebody as a kid comes and builds from scratch, because you would have come without anything, right? So that's a very inspirational
story. He have never said no to us for anything.
Okay.
Whatever we have asked, he have given us. Excellent. Whether he have or no, he will get it done for us. That's the most thing that I like in him. He will never do anything for himself, never shop for himself. But for us, he's always there, whether it is Diwali or whatever it is.
Amazing.
So,
amazing.
It's nice.
So apart from this letter, nothing else, no other crushes. You didn't give letters to anybody.
No. My brother was in the same school. If I would do, he would kick me.
That was the reason you did not give.
No, it's not that. But I was a little shy and
shy also.
So I didn't.
Which college you went to?
SSRPU College. It's near Berthi Cross.
And you finished your BCom, right? That you finished your graduation. BCom is what you did.
2017.
So how was college? I mean, did it change you a lot? Because I changed a lot from school to college. Huge transformation, from the good boy to the bad boy. So did the same thing happen to you?
School, I was very calm, not much talkative, and limited people.
Right.
School to home. College also was the same thing, not talkative and everything. When I joined degree there, I made few friends where I started bunking classes.
Okay.
That was in third year, not first and second year. So little bit change there, being open with people and knowing there. That's the point where we have become little mature of life and other things. So that was a little changing point for me for degree.
After graduation, did you work somewhere? Or?
This was my first job.
First job. So after graduation, this was the first interview that you
had? First interview, and I got selected here.
Oh, amazing. I think somebody, who was the HR at that time? Do you remember? I don't remember because...
It was Chandana.
Chandana was the HR at that time. Excellent. Okay. So Chandana was the one who sourced your profile from somewhere?
No, it was a walk-in interview. I got to know about this with my friend. So they said it's available. So I just came here and they said
Excellent.
Yes. That time there was only one hiring, I guess, for billing executive. So I got.
How many years now you've been working with us? 3 years.
This January it will turn 3 years.
3 years. Wow. Okay. How has been the experience? Okay. I mean, there's nothing to compare because you're working in only one company. So you work in three companies, then you'll know the difference. But still, how's been the experience? I'm sure there's been ups
and
downs.
It was a new life for me as a corporate because we have grown up like a kids. Even till degree, you can say that I was a kid, like funny and all that thing.
Right.
So sudden change from there to a corporate life, you'll have to behave a little different.
Seriously? Yeah, I didn't know you're that kind of a corporate. Okay.
No, I mean, little bit. You can't be all the time funny. And you should also have some responsibility to be taken right. Like that. So I was very nervous when I joined and I didn't know how to be here. So I knew only Pratibha and Kirti sir and Nityashree. So that was enough for me. I used to come, talk to them, finish my work, go home back. So nothing much. Later I started interacting with people and then I was understanding things, how you'll have to change according to the situation. So.
Okay.
It's an experience for me. This is first job, so it's my first experience I can count in my life to make me, for bringing me a change from normal girl from to a corporate girl.
What? Give me some of the good experiences, something which made you very happy, which could have happened.
It was just... 9 months or something when we shifted recently to this building. So I was just doing all my work proactively and everything. So Pratibha ma'am had complimented me saying that, to Kirti saying that she's second Kirti in way of handling the works and everything. So that was something which I felt very happy at that moment, because it's just 9 months and you getting such good compliment and words from your manager is something that you would love to listen every time. So that was very happy moment for me. And then after that, things changed and then many other things.
I don't know. I've got only positive feedback about you across regions as a very sincere, committed person who basically does the job. Only thing people have told me about you have been positive. So you're doing something right.
Maybe, but I thought I'll get few negative points as
No, no. Work-wise, I don't think anybody has given anything negative so far. They've all been very appreciative.
Remember you saying me, you do your work, you do your job, don't care what people say.
Correct.
So I have just fixed that in my mind. Now I want to give my best in my work, no matter what people say in my personal life or anything, I don't care.
Now you told us the happy moment, okay, where you felt very happy. I mean, Pratibha is going to be very inspired listening to, you know, the way she can inspire you, okay, because those words made you very happy. Give us something which made you very sad, where you were very upset.
Very upset is something when I'm not performing in my work better and people are, little upset from that. So that thing I don't like, because I don't want anyone to make upset because of my non-things. So I want always to give my best shot, and so that people can't tell me back in return anything, and they're always, they should be happy from my work. So that's the thing. So sad, small silly things like kabhi in invoicing, if there's something missed out, or in email, why was this not happened, or why did you talk to the customer this way. That is a small silly thing.
Small silly thing, okay. Especially, I think the credit checks also come to you guys only, right? So
that's nothing. That's not a thing. But where customers don't understand and they try to force their point on us, that is something which makes me go a little mad, and I'll be like, sir, please listen to me. Let me clear my point and then you can tell whatever you want. Because some point we will be correct, some point they will be correct. So.
But how is this whole experience? Because see, very few people, I'm experienced at almost everything in this company, except most probably calling up and asking people for money, which they owe us, of course. So how is this experience? I mean, is it when people pick the call, are they happy to pick it up?
Interviewed for this profile, they said you'll also have to do callings. And me, callings, I can't do that. I have told this many times that I can't talk to people, especially when it comes to strangers. So they then at that moment I really needed the job, so I said okay, I'll do it. Learning is the thing which you can never stop in your life. So I said okay, I'll do it. And then when we came, they taught me how to do, and I performed it well. So from there, experience talking to one customer, two customers, three customers, then I realized okay, with every customer you'll have to be diplomatic. You can't talk same to all of the customers. So based on the situation, you need to keep changing. And when it comes to collection part, I mean, There are few
your number has been blacklisted in a lot of customers' phones. Yes?
Not blacklisted. I mean, I have never blacklisted any customers. But yeah, that...
No. Your number would be blacklisted by them because you're calling for money, right? So they block your number.
Some people have blocked and some people, they'll ignore it. Because they know it's my call. So there are good customers, bad customers. Not bad. They're just doing their job.
No, I like what you said just now. They're just doing the job is a lot of maturity. So there's not, they're not really bad customers.
They're not bad.
They most probably don't have
it. It depends on situation.
There's some situation which they have to go through. Some people work differently. So amazing. In terms of the personal equation relationships in G7, you've been 3 years here. So definitely there are going to be friends, enemies, people you love, people you hate. So give me some of the best personal experiences that you've had in the company. Happy ones. Best friends. Mm-hmm.
I don't make friends easily.
You don't make friends easily?
I also don't have, if you ask me friend count list, I don't have that because I don't make. So, in G7, first friend I made was Nitya and, I mean, Keerthi sir, always on top. And then Nitya, because I used to have more conversation with him because he was a trainer for us. So, he have always inspired in the work and he have always been supportive in the work matter. And Nitya is also very good and very supportive, even ma'am too. So, if you come to friends count, first I would say Keerthi sir, and then later I started knowing Gracie, Hari, Chandana.
Okay.
Not much count. I interact with almost everyone, but that friendly bond which you said, that is...
Any uncomfortable relationships with people who you try to avoid? I know some, I don't want to be specific, so I'm hoping you'll tell us.
I want to avoid. I don't want to avoid because they're not my...
Don't use names, but what is it that you don't like about some people? Because I know a list of people who you don't like. Okay, so what is it that you don't like about them? Let's not use names. I'm pretty sure they know. So I'd like them to hear this so that they understand why Radhika basically could be upset with that.
No, I will not take the name, but yes, again, they're just doing their work. So sometimes you'll have to be little patient because you never know what the other person is doing.
Going through.
So you constantly, calling them and asking them to do this, where you know that that person might be a little, where you have already informed that person that I'm doing this, please give me some time, I'll just finish it. So you'll constantly be calling
it.
So that is one thing which I don't like.
But who would call you for work? This should be credit check the sales team, right? The sales team must be calling you for credit check. Nobody else will be calling you and testing you, correct? So this is more or less that team who calls you, is credit check done.
Yeah,
am I right in the assumption? Nobody else?
Only sales team, none apart from them. And support also, we have not much interacted with support. So only if there's any tickets, they reach out to us. So it's always sales team who is in contact with us. So people know who it is.
have you gone for lunches, parties?
Not parties, lunches, yes.
Yes.
So with first when we were in a team as finance and billing at that moment, and then not much, 3-4 times.
Okay. So but no smoking, no drinking, never tried even a beer till date.
No, not beer. I had just taken one sip of wine which Jess had bought for Christmas.
Christmas, oh, okay.
So that one sip which I didn't like it.
You didn't like it. No smoking, never tried a cigarette at all in life. Okay. And even in college in Bangalore, you still basically didn't get spoiled. How come, man?
Family is the only thing. I can say that when I was in my school, my brother was with me and my sister also. And when I went to college, at PUC, okay, there was nobody. Even degree, my brother's school, college is this side and my college is this side.
Okay.
And my sister is also in the same college. So it was like everyone are around you, so you can't do anything.
Amazing. But anyway, it's nice to basically see someone who's still good in today's world, actually speaking, who's not explored all of that stuff. Okay. Mm-hmm. But if asked a question, are you happy with where you are today? I mean,
happy. In some part of time, you'll have to adjust even if you're not happy. So yes, happy. Whereas life is normal, simple, going on. You have family, parents, good job, you're earning well, your colleagues are good, your office is good, boss is good, everything is good. Just go with the flow.
Okay. If I gave you this opportunity, or let's say God gave you this opportunity, where you can basically restart life all over again, okay, totally again, from zero, what would you become? What would you be doing? What would you change?
I would change the country first.
You can go to an the whole idea is you go to another country, new name, new
I would change the country first.
Okay.
Because India is something where before you, the society comes.
Right.
Especially in middle class families, is always society is a top priority. So I will change the country first. I'll
yes, go. It's always about what are people talking about.
Yeah, what are people, what will people say? What will people say? And we don't want to hear that. Right. So I'll just change the country and then I'll start my life however it is going on there also. It's just a flow, go with the flow.
Have you, see, going to college in Bangalore, as talking about society since you spoke about it, you would have seen that there were people who were going out, partying, boyfriends, because at least from what I hear of you, forget up, those were things which you never even most probably got yourself occupied with. So do you miss all of this stuff? Do you think that was a necessary part of growing up, you know, where the experiencing these things were good or?
Not that necessity, but yes, when you see your friends going out or even going in the daytimes, not late night. Late nights, so it's not at all allowed in my home. Even in the daytimes, if you see your friends are going out to some resort or a long trip or something. So if we go for a permission in home, they'll be like, no, you shouldn't, you'll not go. And that time I'll just say please, and then if they say again no, I'll just keep it. I won't argue with them, no, I have to go. So it was like a habit for me to, so that never affected me that people are going out and you're not going out. So from that you should get upset or anything. That never became a habit.
So you're not angry with parents or angry with dad for that?
I was angry with my parents because I tell them, see people, they are afraid of what will happen if you go out. So I'll say them only one thing. I am here in front of you right now. Even if I'm going to an office or college, what if anything happens there? Will you blame the situation? It's a thing which is to happen. So no, that is something which will be near, but going out is something will be far. So don't want. So I just said, okay, whatever it is, get married, do with your husband, go with your husband. So it's something like a husband will be a bodyguard and a security for you to take you out. So that's the thought. So I've never argued and I just let it be.
Since you spoke about the husband in marriage, now you're a pretty single woman. So are you, what's the plans for marriage? Are you looking at self-selection? You're looking at parent selection?
No option for self-selection, so parent selection.
Why? There's always an option. Oh, your dad is going to come and beat me up after seeing this video.
No, it's always parent selection. Even if you have someone in your life and if you want to get married, you can't tell that.
Okay.
They won't agree. So you know that they won't agree. So why unnecessary to create dramas in the home? Just let go of the past and
Let them select, let them make the selection.
Let them make the
but
selection.
In their selection, will you be given a selection where you can still say yes or no? You will be given a choice, right? Okay, good.
So that's one thing which you have given, or else my dad, almost if he see any good guy, he'll like him.
Okay. So his plans are now going? Have you seen any boys already? Is selection process going on? No?
You want me to answer this here?
Yeah. You don't want to answer?
No.
But process is on, that means.
Yeah.
Okay. So how many have you rejected so far? Can you answer that at least?
Maybe five.
Five you rejected?
Five to six.
Okay. Now this one, please try and answer for me. What kind of a guy are you looking for?
Just understand. I don't want something like my father, like restrictions.
Right.
My father is good, motivator, caring, everything. But restricting a child will make a child to, you know, become baggy. So that I don't want from my husband, like restricting for doing things. And even if he's not a good looking, I mean, good looking should also be, that's a point. But even if he's not that good looking, he should be sensible and understanding. That is one major thing which you want in today's life, at least where in family, you can expect that there is someone for your support and understanding. So,
someone with a maturity who is able to. Wish you all the best. Good luck. Okay.
Thank you.
And what is your family's criteria? I mean, they're looking for people who are from the same caste, same religion, same language. I mean,
same caste, always.
Same caste. So that's the primary criteria.
Same caste, same religion, everything should be within that boundary. No intercaste, nothing.
How has been the whole experience right now? Because now I think you have, last 10, 15 years maybe, you always spent most of the day outside because you were either in school or college and so on. I think the last 3 months has been where you most probably been standard at home with family. How has been the experience actually, this work from home?
Beginning of the work from home, it was little difficult for me because when we are at home, parents also start expecting, like, chalo, she's at home, she'll look,
let her cook, let her do this,
take care of the things and everything. And the same equally, even office will expect that chalo, she's at home, she will also do the work properly. So that was little difficult for me, because my mom always she's not well because of the pain in her spinal cord and joints, everything. So, and my sister is little smaller to do all these things, so that was little difficult for me. I had to manage both, and because of that there was a lot of fights, arguments at home, because I was prioritizing my work over that. So they just wanted me to do both simultaneously. So I said, I can't, I'll do only one at a time, which is my office work. I want to finish that. So at one point they stopped seeing me anything. They're like, she's hopeless, just let it be. And they started doing their work. And then after that, things changed again in lockdown. I can say lockdown also was a kind of experience for me to know myself and to know what is right and what is bad. So I changed. Then I realized that what I'm doing at home also is not good, and what I'm doing with myself is also not good. Let me balance it. So I started being normal. I stopped talking at my home from past 1 year, I must say, like no much interaction.
Okay.
Because always I used to be at office, go home, eat, sleep, come back to office, no much interactions, nothing. So that, and now I'm good slowly. At that. Now I'm slowly coping up with all that things and all good. So it's fine.
So it's positive. So at least the
it's
lockdown
all positive. And I see a change in myself also, like, you know me. So that's somewhere changed in me, like the way of thinking and being, everything. So I'm liking that.
I'm seeing thing. A much more confident person than what I seen before the lockdown, at least.
That even I am liking it. And because I just, the day which you told me that, you know, ignore whatever people say, that really hit me hard, and I took that. I'll be like, okay, now I will really not care what people say and I'll do what I like.
Amazing. But overall, your experience as working with G7, okay, if you were the MD, let's say I made you the MD today, what would you change to make it better?
Is I would not become MD, sir.
Why?
That's a very more responsibility task. Like, you'll have to take everyone and go forward. You can't alone think about yourself. You'll have to think about the company, about your employees, your customers, which is very difficult. I get it. So
your dad is in business, right?
Yeah, I will never choose
now,
that
I think
option.
Now you know why you understand that.
I'll never take that option of becoming an MD.
1 minute now, you are the MD for 1 minute only, and you need to do something to improve G7. What would that be?
Okay, I would consider everyone as equal, like no matter whether they're close to me or they're just a normal person to me, everyone are equal in terms of company. If you see, you like some people and they're normal to you, but that doesn't mean you will show some kind of partialism. That is what I don't like in things. I'll take everyone to be treated as equally, whether whosoever.
Okay. Equal in terms of salary, you're saying everybody?
No, not salary. Like
it's in treatment.
In terms treatment.
Of,
so there's nothing here in G7. It's not like personally I'm saying that. I've heard from people also, my friends, everyone say their company stories, right? So that way I'll feel like, okay, G7 is far better, like more better where I am working compared to what you people are. So there I'll prefer, like, if I become an MD of any company, I'll treat everyone as equal, whether they are in term of salary or their job or profile, what they are, low, high, anything, so that thing.
COVID, during this season, there were quite a few things that the company offered. Did any of this, you've not taken advantage of any of that, as far as I know, you've not used any of the things. Thankfully, nobody was COVID impacted in the family. Okay, so thank God for that, and let it be that way only. But did the offers that the company brought out, or the support that the company brought out, did it help you feel a little more secure?
Yes. So when we got to know about this, I told my family. They were like, it's nice initiative what your company has taken. So they were really happy with that. But they know that there's nothing going to happen like that. So they were just having a positive thing that it's nice, good work what your company is doing.
At least there is something.
So I like the whole idea of supporting the employees, whether it is in not only COVID, whether your family is impacted with COVID or not only with that, with other situations also where you can help. I personally would like to thank you for that. So it's like that. So I basically like the whole idea of what G7 takes an initiative to support.
Oh, we try. Okay, but talking about it, I mean, thank you for the positive words. Okay, but in terms of anything else, do you think which you would like to change because it would make you feel happier, make people feel happier? Anything which has come across, maybe somebody you're sitting down and you're thinking, why is this way? It should have changed. It would have been better. Is there anything like that where you'd like to showcase on the show to people?
Spotlight show
is why you don't want it to be there, or you wanted it to be there? You didn't.
No,
want
I want everyone to hear and see, but I don't want to be in that place. So spotlight show.
So far it's going well. You're doing amazingly well.
Yeah, now I got that confidence. But when I heard about this spotlight show where you'll have to interact and you will be on in front of the camera, I was like, no, this shouldn't have happened.
I know that. I heard the reaction. you said you were praying that your name does not get selected, but it got selected. See, God was not listening to you that day. Apart from the spotlight show, anything else that you would like to bring to our notice?
Apart from that,
if you have to advise people, see, you're one of the older employees in terms of the cloud division. The cloud division itself is 3.5 years old. We started July 2016. So, and when did you join?
2018. Jan 2nd, 2018.
So that's 2 years almost, 2.5 years, 3 years almost.
This January, 3 years.
3 years, excellent. So, with this experience in G7, what advice would you give to colleagues who are newly joining? Is there something they can do better? Any advice based on your learning?
I should give an advice to the new joiners especially. Well, what I heard from people, so they're all maybe from some or the other corporates, they've just moved and they're here. So I am not the right person for them to advise because they are in themselves have much experience. So I can maybe take an experience from them because I have seen almost everyone are senior departments like marketing head.
Senior times. Recently we've been taking senior.
Yeah,
people.
Senior types only. So like, I can take an experience. I have nothing to advise to them. It's just that we are a family. Simple.
Perfect. Now I'm going to ask you something which is controversial. Now I'm going to give you four names of people. Okay. And I'm going to ask you to rate them from, not rate them, you need to name them in order of good to bad.
Okay.
Okay. So the first name will be very good and next names may not be very bad, but the first name you say is very good, 2, 3, 4. Four names I'm going to give you. Ready?
Okay.
Kirti, Deepak, Pratibha, Ningappa.
Recently I've started interacting with Deepak sir and so first always Kirti sir and then Pratibha ma'am.
Okay.
Then Deepak sir and then Ningappa sir.
Then Ningappa last. Okay.
Because Ningappa sir not much.
Not interacting much with him.
So he's good. It's not like I'm keeping him last. So he's good. He's very good.
Excellent. some experiences which we'd like to basically know now. You're pretty sure that your personal life is going to be an arranged marriage. Are you planning to marry in Bangalore? Are you going to continue working after marriage? Or are we going to basically, you're going to become the full-time housewife after marriage? What's your thinking? What happens will happen, but what is your thinking?
My mind is very clear. Even after marriage, I want to work. I don't want to sit idle at home just doing the house stuff. I have no problem in doing house stuff, but sitting and doing the same thing whole day, that's not something I want. I want everything to be done. So I will work even after my marriage also. And I'm planning for a Bangalore
husband.
Bangalore itself. So let's see how the situation goes.
Okay, amazing. What do you do in your spare time now? See, you don't go out too much. You don't pub, you don't party too much. So when you're not working and you're having spare time, TV, what is your favorite time pass?
TV, I'll say I stopped watching when I joined G7.
Oh, seriously? So don't watch TV also?
No, okay. I don't watch. Because I always used to be at office and while traveling, phone was the only medium to watch whatever you want. So TV, I stopped. And then in my free time, I'll just sit idly, talk to my mom, trouble my sister, listen to music or see, watch something in my phone, any series or something. Okay. And then after that, if I feel like, I'll go and start cooking because I like food. So I'll start cooking and eating anything.
Are you a vegetarian or non-vegetarian?
I was vegetarian. Recently, I'm trying to convert to non-vegetarian.
You're trying to convert to non- at home, but they eat non-veg? Or?
No, no. So only egg.
So, pure vegetarian. So, what is the worst thing ever you ever eaten till date?
Worst thing?
Worst thing you've eaten, according to you?
Boiled vegetables.
Boiled vegetables? Boiled vegetables is a good thing now.
I am foodie. Like, I want nice, tasty, nice yummy, chatpata
food. Okay, so the worst thing you've eaten is boiled vegetables.
Boiled vegetables. Okay. And I don't like vegetables much, but now I have started taking healthy food, so I'm eating. It's okay. But vegetables is something which I'll say, boiled one especially.
Perfect. So we're going to take you into the next round, Radhika. This is a rapid fire round. So we're going to ask you 5 questions, okay? And you will be answering every question as to the rules of the game is that you cannot tell me no one. You have to give me one name. Okay. The answer has to be the name of a
person.
A name of a individual. Okay. So ready?
Yeah.
The person who gossips the most in G7.
Gossips? Yeah. I've never come across any person like that.
That cannot be the answer.
Gossip? About everything?
Gossip just keeps on talking about people, other people all the time. I mean, the gossiper, the biggest gossiper. Gossip is unnecessary talk, right? So
unnecessary talks. Okay.
Biggest gossiper in G7, which you know of. They might be bigger, but maybe you don't know them. According to your circle, the people who you know, the people who you interacted with, who's the biggest gossiper?
Kavita aunty.
Okay. So question number one, we've got an answer. Now, second question. Who's the biggest cribber in G7? Who's always crying? Ye teek nahi hai, wo teek nahi hai, this is a problem, that is a problem. Who's the biggest cribber?
Okay.
It could be me also. You can give any name, whichever you feel. Okay.
Like taking everything, they'll cry.
Yes. More or less. I mean, they're always cribbing about something. They're always.
There's no such name. Okay, I'll tell Kavita aunty again because she's in administration. So things, if it's not in right place, she will cry for that.
Okay. So we got 2, 3. Okay, who's the hottest guy in G7 according to you and the ones you've seen? If you don't know their name and you've seen them, you can just describe them, I'll give the name.
I've not seen any. The only person I know is Kirti sir, so I'll take him as
Kirti
the hottest.
Is the hottest guy. Hottest woman in G7?
Jess.
Okay. If you had an opportunity to kill someone in G7 and you had to do this, who would it be?
Alok.
A lot of people want to kill Alok. We need to basically buy him protective gear, actually speaking. Anyway, congratulations. You did really well on the rapid fire. Okay, you answered all the questions. You're one of the few people who answered all those questions. So thank you so much. We have 2 gifts for you. One is this cup, okay, which we're going to give. One is for you and one is for us. So you need to put your signature on this and the date. And okay. We'll put this in a showcase upstairs. Okay, so here is the pen and the cup. Thank you very much, Radhika. And that one you can take home with you when you're going. That was for you.
Okay.
And apart from this, I have another gift for you. But firstly, let me thank you from the bottom of my heart for everything you do for G7. Okay, you really work hard. You basically ensure that money comes in. Talk to the customers. Continue to support us this way. You are really responsible in a big way to the success we are seeing today.
I'll thank everyone, sir. Everyone has taught me some other thing here.
Sure. I'm going to give you 5,000 rupees of Amazon gift vouchers. Okay. So you can actually go and buy yourself something for Diwali. Okay. So this is...
Thank you.
Okay. So thank you so much for being on the show, Radhika. And thank you for being a part of G7 family.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.